Madam, I am of course thankful to you for giving me this opportunity to reply to such a very interesting, very engaging and very enlightening debate that took place in the last 2 days in this august house. And I am very glad to see that almost more than half of the house participated in this debate. That shows the type of involvement that each of the members of this august house, the honorable members of the parliament belonging to Lok Sabha, have in the railways. So I really first of all thank each one of you, those who participated either speaking or by presenting or by listening to this debate in the last 2 days, has shown a keen interest in railways. So on behalf of railway family, let me thank each one of you for being so engaged in this process. Madam, I know the debate has gone on for more than 13-14 hours. So I wish I could reply to every person who has said something, but that will take probably 28 hours, which will not permit me, and no one will like to participate in that. So I would like to cover the major points that have emerged from the debate. However, each of the points that has been mentioned has been noted by me personally or by my colleague, Mr. Manoj Sinha, and by some of my officers, and will definitely make sure that we act on each of those which have been mentioned here. Madam, I am very thankful to the members of this house. Of course, they belong to the treasury benches, but also belong to this part of the house, who have congratulated this budget and also said that this is the budget which really helps us to move forward. Why have they said this? Because that shows that railway is a national asset. We really need to develop railways in a way that is not politicized. Railway is something which should happen in a professional run, in a professional manner. And to make that happen, each of the members has expressed his keen interest. So this budget philosophy, in fact, was essentially that. We felt that railways need to be run in an extremely professional manner. All the investment decisions that railway make must take into account the aspirations and the hope of so many people, not just sitting here, but millions of people outside. But at the same time, we should run it in a way that railways will be able to cater to the demands for the short term, but also will be able to sustain itself commercially, economically, in the medium and long term. And to make that happen, what was necessary was to have a type of consolidation for the railways, which we are trying to attempt in this budget. What is the consolidation? Madam, if you look at the discussion, the tone and the tenor of the discussion, and the content of suggestions, most of the people have said that there was an announcement in the budget. That announcement was never matched by any budgetary provision. There have been announcements made number of times of the same project. We all raised expectations, hopes, but we could not fulfill them only because the expectations were not fulfilled because there was no enough matching amount to be provided. So the budget should be an exercise in which we should try to put where the mouth is. They should put some money where it is needed, and that's what we could not do only because, and there is, I not want to blame anybody because of this, is because the demand was so high and the resources were so scarce, so railway could not cater to it. And therefore, over a long period of time, there has been ongoing projects which will never be completed, it looks like, or could be completed at probably several times over than the original cost of the project. So initially, some of the projects were not considered viable because the internal rate of return was not so good. But now, if you look at today's prices, then they will never be probably viable. So we have to now, therefore, choose a process in which all the projects which are necessary for the railway's interest, all those who are interested in this project, we need to undertake in the interest of the people who really need them. We must try to have a trade-off. How do you take projects which will help railways so that railways is become commercially viable, more sustainable, so it can invest more? At the same time, the aspirations of the people must be taken into account. And that's a fine balance we need to achieve. And that's why in this budget, we announce first that we'll take up such projects like doubling, like tripling, like something which will increase efficiency, which in short term will give benefit to the people. I know there are so many friends of mine, including my friend Dr. Satyapal Singh, who resigned his job as a police commissioner to join politics. I don't know whether he is now regretting it or not. But when he did that, he came and told me once, how do I travel from Delhi to Baghpat? The train runs at 20 kilometers an hour. Is it a train or a bullock cart? So that's a very good question. Now just imagine, why does it happen? There is a single track. Train stops at every station. because if every station people feel that why can train go from here but it cannot stop here, so as a result of that the train never reaches the destination in desired time. So to make sure that we address some issues, we thought we must do doubling. Like there is a huge demand for doubling. Doubling would mean no new land acquisition. We can complete the project fast. The people demand of so many of them can be fulfilled very quickly. Railways will start earning revenue. If a new railway line costs about say 10 to 11 crores a kilometer, the line for doubling may cost only half of that. And therefore we can do it with better IRR, and that's what we did in consolidation, and I'm very happy that all of you have endorsed this idea and we are going to work on it. Sir, many people have said, and I'll come to that, about a dream, and I'll come to that. I'm very happy that people have raised this issue. I'll address it adequately. But a second point of this budget was short-term benefits without compromising long-term interest. And that's why I mentioned that this is what we are trying to do it in this manner. Safety was another great consideration. Many of you have said that so many people die by accidents, and that is something which is a serious matter. And I personally feel that I am also responsible as a railway minister if there is an accident which takes place. It may be easy to say that because unmanned level crossing, the railways have right of way, which is a fact. So if any vehicle is coming, it is actually intruding. It's a trespassing. But at the same time, a life lost is a too precious thing to be ignored. And therefore, in this budget, we have provided highest amount of money as well as attention to safety. And we are trying to do 3,400 unmanned level crossings we are trying to avoid, and also try to do the highest ever 970 RUBs and ROBs. In addition to that, some members made very good suggestions. Why not, including my friend Mr. Chautal? He mentioned, why not we use technology for this? And this is absolutely right. We have already created a partnership with RDSO, which is the Government of Railway Organization, and with ISRO and with NRSA to find out how could we use geospatial technology to actually make it happen. If there is a moving object which is coming in, if we can know where when we send it to the moon, it can track it. Why we should not be able to track something which is moving on the surface and which is moving at a particular pace? We could alert, obviously, by sending sound as well as some light signals to the people who are crossing it. We are trying to work on that as well. But I am saying this is the topmost priority. I hope we succeed in eliminating them in the over period of time. Again, the fund being concerned, but still, despite all this, we have put 3,400 unmanned level crossing removal as a priority. Customer first has been a focus, because as you know, and many of you have said, that we must look at the face of the poor first. And that's what Mahatma Gandhi always used to say, that you should really look at his face and decide whether he is happy, then the society should be happy. And if that is the case, looking at his face, we really realize that we have to do much more than what we have been doing so far. And that's why we have provided so many things for customer services, which I don't want to repeat. Many of my colleagues from either side have mentioned about it. But customer is a focus, and that's why we want to do it. Again, railway cannot just be a commercial enterprise. Though many people would like to say that, but not in the house, of course, but many others outside. Railway has to be a socio-economic, political organization as well. We cannot ignore the reality that so many people in the country who may not be having enough purchasing power, but this is one of the big means of transportation for them. Like we say, this is a popular transport of last resort for the poor. And if it is the case, we must keep the character of social, economic, political of nature of these railways intact. To make that, the railways must be really strong enough. If you want the railway to serve the poor, you cannot serve the poor if poor feel that railway is a means of last resort and railway itself is not viable. How can railway then be serving the poor? So the best service that we can provide to the poor is by making railway strong financially, commercially, as well as technologically. And that's what we are trying to do in this budget. The other issue was transparency. And I think there we are really put a lot of focus on that. I would come to this. Some of the people have mentioned the railway, there is a lot of corruption. And I'm not denying that at all. I know it's a reality. All of us must work on it. We must make sure that we eliminate it. At least while we work for an elimination, we must try to take number of measures to reduce it. So first step that I said is, we delegated the powers to the general managers and everything, which I used to enjoy as a railway minister. But now we want to delegate the powers further to the DRMs, to the station master, as well as bring everything under the e-portal platform. If we can do everything which is e-tendered, we can really reduce the corruption in a significant manner. At the same time, if we can look at the corruption, which is one is at the high level, which you talk about. But the people suffer from corruption at low level as well. The TT taking 100 rupees, people really feel bad. So we are trying to push CCTV. There is a now huge possibilities that whenever you are carrying a mobile, and you can use a, because every mobile nowadays has camera, and there are 900 million telephone users. So therefore, we can say that most of the travelers are also telephone users. So if you can use the camera, take a picture, all these pictures can be uploaded on the new portal that we launched on Monday. I'll come to it, how the implementation is concerned. But that will make sure that we can actually make sure that we can track the person who is trying to harass the person, the RPF is not behaving properly, the women are properly, women are troubled, all of that can be happened. So transparency is something which is the most important part that we must try to do that in a proper manner. The long term and short term are both we are taken into account, and the commercial viability is already been put. In fact, talking about a poor, the general coach of 24, to increasing the number for at least 2 to 3 coaches, we already announced in the budget, which will be reserved for these poor people. So this is our focus. As the Prime Minister always believes that whatever we do, and as I said in my budget speech as well, that our first priority and the governance should really aim at reducing the adversity of the poor. And if we can succeed in doing that, automatically we'll be able to work on that. Some people have raised a larger issue. I don't know how much time we really have, but I'll just tell you in a few minutes, including my friend from Orissa. He mentioned about freight and fare issue. We feel that at the time of independence, we had a significant share, most dominant share was road, and then railway, and then we lost it to road over a period of time. We forget one important fact. This has nothing to do with commercial issues alone. This is largely because the road network at that time was not as big as it is today. Rail network did not expand from what it was at that time. The rail network expanded rapidly. The investment that we made in road as a percentage of GDP was 3 times or 4 times higher than the investment that we made in railways. So the result is obvious. So this is nothing to do with only commercial that we increase freight rate, that's why we lose the tariff. Plus, if you really look at it, and that's what my friend from Kerala was just now pointing out, if you just look at it, even if you want to bring more traffic from road to rail, you have the capacity to handle. And if you don't have the capacity to handle, what are we talking about? Rail-road ratios and that time to be generalized, reading somewhere, that this is what is going to distort it. So to make that happen, if you really want to bring more cargo to rail from road, then we must invest in railways. You must increase the network, and that is what we are trying to do. So therefore, this is again a very important step that we are taking in this budget, which should again help us to do that. Some people, and rightly so, have asked me about operating ratio. Before that, let me tell you about an important issue that some of the person mentioned. I am really surprised that we talk about dream. I think everybody, our first Prime Minister of India, also said I had a dream. Then every other Prime Minister, right from Dalai Lama to anybody. So is it a crime to have a dream? Or this is not our dream alone, this is not my dream. What I mean, I mentioned in my budget speech, it is not a Prime Minister dream. This is a dream of India. All those millions of people who travel by railway, that is their dream, which we want to fulfill. But a dream alone will not be able to realize unless we have an action plan. And this budget is an action plan to realize that dream. But in this budget, some people, particularly Mr. Venugopal, and just now you mentioned a very valid point, is what is the budget, because we had put large number of policy issues into the budget speech. I just want to tell you, this is a document issued by the budget manual, issued by the Ministry of Finance in September 2010. It says, the budget essentially, a presentation part. While presenting the budget on the scheduled day of the Lok Sabha, this is, of course, deals with finance minister, but that same thing applies to railway minister because railway doesn't prevail. Makes a speech giving entirely details of the proposal for the new financial year regarding taxation, borrowings, and expenditure plans of the government. The budget speech is largely a policy document whereby the finance minister states the salient features of the financial administration of the year. So what I'm just saying, I don't want to read the whole thing, but what I said in my budget speech was not deviating something from what is not mentioned. What I mentioned in my the annexure was only to save the time of the house. I could read it if you wanted to read it, but I just did not do it. But what I mentioned is an operating ratio, which is the net result of the financial statement. End of the day, where do you arrive at a financial operating ratio? Operating ratio comes in because you have this statement of income and expenditure. In operating ratio, people have asked me how you arrived at this operating ratio. So I'll come to it a little later as to how we have increased the target. And when I come to the freight target, I'll explain to you in detail how we have done that. But we have done a number of other measures. This time, we have really concentrated on the expenditure side of the budget as well. We are trying to target the cost of energy. The electricity that the railway consumes is being bought at a very high rate. I was used to be the power minister. And therefore, when I became a railway minister, I said we are paying too much for the railways, because railway is the single largest user of energy, electricity, and paying the highest. It should be the other way around. If you go to the market and buy the highest, you buy 1,000 product and somebody is buying one, the person who is buying 1,000 will get a discount. So we were getting that, so we actually are targeting that. I already directed that they must work on, and I worked with Ministry of Power that to make sure that this is the properly in the government domain that we work on this. So this is one way. We also try to cost-cutting, outcome-oriented operation that we are trying to work on, and advertising and source of other revenues like that. That brings us to the important issue that some of you have mentioned, is where we got this target and where are you going to get this 1,200, the highest number of amount of tonnage that we'll handle. I must tell you something. This house itself, only in the last few days, and our Parliament Affairs Minister has been instrumental in helping all of you to pass that legislation, has passed two important legislation along with others. One was a coal ordinance, which now converted into law, converted into bill and now passed by the Lok Sabha. Other is the mining one. Madam, now, as a consequence of this, there is going to be a huge movement of raw material from mines to the processing point. They will be manufactured, so there will be going to be movement of finished goods from the manufactured point to the market, and as a result of which, there is going to be a huge demand for railways. If the railways don't cater to this at this time, then we are not going to be making money. At the same time, all these activities also will not come to standstill, despite the fact that now we have created a legislative network. So therefore, we created, and therefore I gave this target. I am very happy that my colleagues in the Railway Ministry have responded to it so well that they have prepared on their own a target of 1,200 metric million tons. And as a result of which, each of these zone, and this is only an action plan for one zone, which is for the East Coast Railway. Each zone has been told how to raise it, what are the constraints, what investment you need, where do you need to put money, and all of that has been done. So therefore, this is something which will happen without any difficulty, we feel. Of course, there could be some issues. Again, on the customers and how they will be able to come on such a number. Already, we are trying to increase the presently carries 23 million passengers per day through 49 lakh berth seats. The generation of 5,87,251 additional berth seats per day constitute nearly 11.9% total carrying capacity. And that's why we are trying to increase the capacity by also putting in the number of coaches. All of this information is available there. So therefore, this budget, which has been prepared, is not prepared on something, but it has been prepared on the basis of this. Again, the question, and a valid one that you asked me just now, is how to increase from 1 billion tons to 1.5 billion tons. Essentially, this is because of the dedicated freight corridor, which should become operational, along with other measures that we are taking, this number of measures like doubling and tripling and other things that would happen. This will easily be possible. And in fact, rather than saying is it possible or not, we have to make it possible. Because if we do not handle 1.5 billion tons of cargo, how our economy can grow at 8-9%, which is poised to grow? The other sectors are firing, the cylinders are firing, and we just keep quiet. It is not going to work. And that's why we are really working on that in a significant way. The other question, and a valid question, people ask me about, where do you get money? So I just said yesterday to the House that we not only got money, but you got money with honey. Why I said with that is because we got a money with such a softener and such a sweetener that Life Insurance Corporation of India, one of the premier institutions of the country, which buys, which sells policies to the policyholder for a 30 years, 40 years period. Now just imagine, the policyholder is going to pay for 30 years. He's not going to be paid for 30, 40 years, and every year there are new policyholders coming in. So insurance corporation always have typically the funds for 30 year generation, 30 year duration, and 30 year maturity. Railways, actually not only railways alone, but any infrastructure organization in the world needs money like that, of that duration. Because that railways should also be able to put money, try to generate resources, put back resources, try to earn more. As a result of it, then they will be able to work better. So this is how this has been done. But this is only 1.5. I had mentioned about 8.5 lakh. Let me explain to you how we are going to get it. So I am not explaining in detail about all the details, because I knew this 1.5 lakhs for with LIC even when I presented a budget, but didn't mention. Because let us sign it and I will come back to you. But this is all in advanced stage of negotiation. So all this money will be available, but I will tell you how. First, let me tell you where this 8.5 lakh figure came from. This is Annex 1 to the budget document. One is network decongestion, including DFCSR electrification. It is about 2 lakh crores. In electrification, there is a possibility that one could also get large supplies credit. So therefore, that money can come also in a different way. Network expansion with electrification, again the same thing. There are certain national aid projects. There is 1 lakh crore, which has been mentioned for special redevelopment and logistic park. This money, railway did not put at all. If, as I have said, we announced a policy, I have mentioned in the budget, which now we are going to the cabinet, anybody can come and develop land and air rights for the development of a station. So this money we will not put. But a balance money of say 7 lakh crores, where we will get it? My colleague, who is not present here today, the finance minister, has been so supportive. Even if we take at a very conservative level of gross budgetary support, which he has promised much more, but I am not even taking that, of say 50,000-60,000 crores a year, that itself becomes 2.5 lakh crores a year. LIC 1.5 lakh, that makes 4 lakh crores. World Bank, IFC, as well as the ADB, we are negotiating with them, and that itself will again give us a substantially large amount of money, which is significant large, and again on a very soft term. This is something which will be available for repayment over a long period of time, a very soft source of money. Again, there are institutions like India Infrastructure Finance Limited, NBFC owned by the Government of India. That again, as we are negotiating with them a joint venture. State Bank of India, we are also signing with the PSU like coal and others an MOU in the next few days, so that we will actually use their money which is lying surplus with them and create lines which will be win-win, because they will get new lines, so they will be able to evacuate the coal. We'll get a freight without doing this. So all of this, and then tax-free bonds, which is mentioned by the finance minister in budget speech, as well as infra fund, which the Minister of Finance is creating, maybe over a period of time for 2 lakh crores, largely will be drawn by us. And therefore, I'm not even calculating in this the pension funds and others which are already talking to. I am more than confident that we'll be able to get the money, and not only confident, this is all been negotiated at a high level. But what I'm just saying is, when we made this commitment, the question is not how we'll get it. Now I have told you how. But
Mr. Minister, 1 minute, please. Maniya Sabha Sadot, abhi 6 baj gaye hain. Agar Sabha ki sehmati ho, to Sabha ki karwai 1 ghante ke liye bada
dete. This is the reply of the minister. You completed.
Uske baad thoda sunne.
Shunya
kaal.
You will pass it.
Shunya kaal bhi thoda sa.
1
ghante ke liye bada.
7 baje khat.
Yes. Dhanyawad. धन्यवाद धन्यवाद जी. एक घंटे के लिए बढ़ा देते हैं. यस मिस्टर मिनिस्टर.
सो मैडम, एज माय फ्रेंड जस्ट नाउ वाज सेइंग दैट गेट मनी लाइक दिस बट डोंट प्राइवेटाइज. सो आई जस्ट एक्सप्लेन टू यू द मनी दैट वील गेट विदाउट दैट. बट आर वी रियली, एनी वन ऑफ अस शुड बी अगेंस्ट द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ पीपीपी? आई थिंक आई एम वेरी हैप्पी दैट ऑल द different parties have always expressed an opinion about this from time to time. Let me read something interesting, and then you'll feel. This is something which is mentioned in a budget speech. In this time has come to the business community to come and join hands to build partnership with railways. Sometimes they have problems, they are keen to invest, but their proposals are unduly delayed by typical negative approach. Please pardon me for saying, but it is a fact that administrative and procedural delays, external and internal, do take place, discouraging property investors. And therefore, I decided to set up a special task force to clear proposal for investment within 100 days. Our policy guideline will follow. Same speech, little later, I'm just bringing firm point. The need of the hour is to develop new business model to initiate domestic investment through PPP mode in areas like new lines of world-class station, etc. The speech delivered by one of the person whom I admire more, also I really love and respect, is Mamata Banerjee. So she said this, and I really respect her for that. Then I am very happy that there has been such a consistency in thinking like this that my good friend Mr. Kharge mentioned in his budget speech that we must try to target 1 lakh crore of FDI. This is what you have mentioned. I think I just read it properly. If I don't make a mistake, let me just tell you. But I am just saying. No, no, Mr. Kharge Saab has said, and which is rightly so, I don't say anything. He said, apart from attracting private investment from domestic investors on the rural sector, a proposal under consideration of the need to enable foreign investment for faster creation of world-class infrastructure. Sorry, 1 lakh crore you have not mentioned, but this is what you mentioned. And the second part of Mr. Pawan Kumar Bansal, just before that, also mentioned very correctly that public-private partnership, an ambitious target of 1 lakh crore, that is what Mr. Pawan Kumar Bansal said, has been said to attract investment through PPP route during the 12th plan. Now, if I am trying to fulfill the aspirations, the wishes of such great distinguished leader, I don't think anybody should have any fault in finding that what we are doing is wrong. We are only trying to take forward the philosophy, the ideas that were propagated by such a distinguished railway minister like this. In fact, I am overawed by the fact that such distinguished people, right from Lal Bahadur Shastri to such this railway minister, that we are such a great distinguished railway minister. So we must have a continuity. We cannot just say that now I am changing my policy only because I am now minister and somebody else has not been a minister. So in fact, I should be very happy to say that Mamata ji's ideas, philosophy, we are definitely trying to take forward. We are trying to take forward a philosophy of Kharge ji and others, and we'll make sure that we'll not falter in taking it forward. So the point is about, will it result into? This is something which is a budget speech. So this is all property of the house. So I'm just reading from there. Sir, other point is whether this type of a debt we take, how will we be able to repay? That a question Kharge ji also asked me, a very valid one. Sir, I will tell you something. Railways have a very unique balance sheet, or we can say unique financial situation. If we increase your capacity to carry more, not necessarily in the same proportion, the expenses goes up. There is something like a concept of fixed cost and a variable cost. So the more volume increase, the recovery of fixed cost is on a much higher volume. So therefore, the profitability of the organization increases a lot. So if you can actually make investments into railways in a significant way, automatically what would happen is this would result into creation of more revenues, and that revenue itself will be able to take it forward. But this is something I'm not talking to you only as generic term. I requested the State Bank of India chairperson Arundhati Bhattacharya and SBI CAPS. We already appointed them, and we have created a finance cell in the ministry. And this has happened only in the last 2 weeks. Today is the 2 weeks back only I presented the budget. So this is all under implementation. I'll come to it a little later because my good friend Venugopal wanted to know whether dream and reality. So I'll tell you about that. But this is something if you are doing, and therefore we'll make sure that each of these, and this particular have an advisory board of Arundhati Bhattacharya, K.V. Kamath, Rajiv Lal, and even some other Raghav Bell. So they will actually make sure that we are on the right path and will not try to do that. Does it mean that we are privatizing? No. Railways will continue to be owned by the people of India. Railways will be a national asset and which will continue to be there. Like when you talk about PPP, like you talk about FDI, you never had these ideas about it. So why you think now that because we are doing it, it is something else? We'll continue with the same idea, same philosophy that you have, and we'll continue to work on the same basis that you have mentioned in this. And it is mentioned even by our Prime Minister. When he went to Varanasi, his constituency, he mentioned publicly that railways will not be privatized. I think we should take that word as the last word and should dispel any fear that we may have in our minds about whether this will happen or not. The other point, and which is mentioned about, is implementation. And this is a very important issue that my good friend Venugopal has raised. And I cannot ignore Venugopal because he can spring to his feet anytime. So therefore, I must say that what Venugopal has said is a very important issue. And I must tell you how we are implementing it. I will just give you only few because I don't want to take time. Madam, each of these budget announcement that was made has been segregated into individual person. The chairman of the railway board and the members of the railway board, I must thankful to them. have already taken upon themselves the responsibility of implementing each of these. 15 days reporting will happen, and each of these points on Friday, Thursday, budget was presented. We are started working on that. But I'll just give few, not just more. And if you permit me, helpline. I'd mentioned helpline will start. We announced the budget on Thursday. Monday, helpline was launched. The first day itself, we got thousands of calls on that. LIC, I told you, financial, I told you, Tire Club Council. In fact, this is something which is the idea. And many of you have mentioned this, so I'm just deliberately taking up this point, including my friend from Orissa and others, that we railways should look like a professional organization, so they must think differently. They must think on the lines that they are running an organization which has to run profit as well as serve the society. To make this, it's like Tire Club of the railway. So we must have Tire Club Council. I don't want to name him today. I will come back to you soon. We are appointing a very honorable man to head this council. And this council also will have a representative of both the unions. So the unions, as well as some of the distinguished people, will work on finding out how we'll do it. And this Tire Club Council will be also notified in the next few days' time. PPP cell, Make in India. Already I have requested Dr. Saraswat, who is a member of the NITI Aayog, who is to be heading DRDO, a very distinguished scientist, to help us to prepare a roadmap how we can make most of the things the railway makes in India, and therefore he is going to work on the roadmap along with the RDSO, which is our organization. Regulation, which I had mentioned in my budget speech, Dr. Panigriya, Arvind Panigriya, Vice Chairman of NITI Aayog, and Ajay Shankar, who is the member of, who is the secretary of DIPP earlier, they will work on this. And delegation, which I already decided, Dr. Sridharan, I told him he has submitted report to me yesterday, so that again has been implemented. I can talk about all of this, but this is already under implementation, so I'm very happy that you have taken up this point, and this was only a reminder to me. So good friend only can remind, because you want me to succeed. So I'm very happy about it, and we'll definitely make sure that we'll work on each of these, including signing the PSUs as well as the states in the next few days' time. So you cannot reach the destination unless you board the train. I just boarded the train. So the partnership that we are trying to make is with many partners. One is states. Madam, I want to tell you, this is a historic, in my opinion, a decision. Kerala, Tamil Nadu, states, Odisha, the states like that, is to always come and say that we have always been discriminated against. Andhra Pradesh, I mean, you can name them. Each state felt that they are discriminated against. We are also. Till such time, there was chief minister there, others, this Diwar was left hired. So we said, why not we work on such a way that each of these states is become partner. So madam, I wrote to all the chief ministers, I met each one of them. I'm very happy to say that we have signed a partnership. So now just imagine, now we have an avenue open in which implementation of project can happen, not just through railways, but to the states. So therefore, many of the demands that have been made today, we have now other avenue available. We can go to the states, and the states will be able to put capital, will be able to implement through the same thing we'll do through PPP as well as PSU. Madam, the city transport is an important issue. I know there are friends from Bangalore or friends from Kerala and many others that said, I can assure you that though this is a responsibility, really speaking, with the Urban Transport Ministry of the Government of India, we'll work with them as well as the states to create a roadmap for creating an urban transport system. My good friend Anand Kumar, as well as my friends from Kerala and others, have always been telling me, Mr. Mohan, who has given 1 crore to MPLAD, I cannot forget that, and therefore we really need to work on that. Madam, Northeast, some members raised this issue. What about the Northeast region? Madam, we have really increased our outlay substantially. This year, Railway commissioned some lines which I am not mentioning, but I want to tell you something. For Northeast and Jammu and Kashmir, we have already provided 5,300 crores for Northeast, and we are already working on the completion of the projects in Kashmir. But I will assure you, assure the House through you, madam, that no money will be left. With if money is required, we'll try to find the money, but this will remain a priority for all the times to come. Madam, there have been so many suggestions about new trains. Venugopal said we need 1,000 new trains to carry so many passengers. Actually, we'll what we'll do is, when we are already we are already working on it. We are creating a very scientific basis. I'm sure we'll be able to satisfy the demands of the people, keeping in mind the reality of railway situation that exists today as well. Madam, there has been some issue which was raised about freight. And people said that you have increased freight, which is something which is going to happen. Let me first explain what we have done. Madam, we have actually not increased the freight alone. We have decreased it in so many cases. It's a freight rationalization. Railways have a number of slabs in which different categories of goods that are transported are clubbed, and then each category is charged at a particular rate. This is done from time to time. This is not the first time it has been done. But this time we did not increase the freight. We have only done rationalization, which has resulted into some surplus for railways. And the question was, like for example, the long distance cargo. Cargo going to Northeast, should it be costing more just because it's going to Northeast? Cargo going to Kerala, should it just cost more because from Delhi to Kerala distance is long? We have rationalized it to help such states. So in those cases, the freight has decreased. In some cases, it has increased. But this is an increase. But the question is whether it will result into inflation. That was the question. I don't want to claim, give my own opinion because this may be biased. This is an opinion by CRISIL. CRISIL is an independent agency. They have done the impact analysis. They have said there will be virtually no effect on inflation as a result of this minor adjustment that has been made to the freight. But is it something which has been done for the first time? Let me tell you again, there are some illustrious ministers before me who increased in 2012 by 25%, in 2010-11 by 3.5%, again 5.8% in 2013-14. So this is not the first time. This has happened many times. And therefore, we have increased it in a very moderate way, but that again is a rationalization, not increase. So therefore, I'm sure that should again not create any adverse impression in the minds of others. Madam, the states, which are so important part of India, and therefore, we, as I told you, will implement number of projects. So many of the suggestions that have come today, I will sit with the states, find out which other projects can go to the states. We'll put equity. States will put equity. We'll be able to get loan for that because it's a company. There are many agencies which are willing to give loan to such states. I only talk to them on behalf of the states. So we'll be able to do that. But madam, I'll just permit me for a few minutes to say about the states. And that is something I'll give only broad figure. And I'm comparing it in not last year, but the last terminal year of the UPA government, 2013-14. How much has been the increase or decrease in the outlay? Andhra Pradesh got in 2013-14 1,024 crores. This year the allocation is 2,554 crores. Assam and northeastern states, in 13-14, it was 2,330 crores. It has increased to 5,330 crores. In case of Bihar, it was 1,245 crores. It has become 2,303 crores. In case of Delhi, it is very small, 4,045 crores. But I'm sure Mr. Arvind Kejriwal should be happy. It has become 1,274 crores. We are 22 crores. Delhi, I made a mistake. Delhi was 22 crores, it has become 184 crores. Chhattisgarh was 445 crores, become 1.274 crores. Gujarat, 804 crores, has become 3,000 crores. Himachal Pradesh, Haryana, 127 crores. My friend Chautala should be happy. It has become 729 crores. Himachal Pradesh, a very paltry sum of 54 crores, which you just mentioned, it has become 305 crores. Jammu and Kashmir, 1544 crores has become 1636 crores. Jharkhand, 481 crores to 1,770 crores. And in case of Karnataka, which has from 1,288 crores to 2,836 crores. From Kerala, 267 crores to 1,050 crores. In case of Madhya Pradesh, 663 crores, which has become 3,011 crores. Maharashtra, and my friends will be very happy. You are raising your hand, so I think I should tell you the real news. 1,474 crores has become 5,470 crores, which does not include the MUTP also. Odisha, 1,073 crores to 3,628 crores. And yeah, so this is 116 crores from Punjab has become 1,059 crores. Rajasthan, I'll come back to you also. That give me 2 minutes. Rajasthan, 433 crores has become 2,449 crores. Tamil Nadu, 89 crores to 1,452 crores. Telangana, 258 to 6,666. Uttarakhand, 676 to 374. Uttar Pradesh. Pradesh, 756 to 4185. Now West Bengal. Yeah. West Bengal had a
please,
in case
please,
of West
please, this is not the way.
West Bengal in 2011-12 to 10,000 crore. I'm just giving example because you felt that we are discriminated against West Bengal, which is not true. Then in 2012-13, which becomes 6,000 crore, and in case of 2013-14, the last year of UPA, it was 1,604 crores. So it had already come down, not by us, but already. This time we increased it to 3,615 crores. So we'll try to do even more as we go along. But I'm just saying, and this is something on each.
Please.
All of this is the proof.
Please.
So what I'm saying is, all states, in addition to this,
in addition to this, yes, you
yeah. In addition to this, madam, now as I explained to you that we are tied up with LIC and others, there is probably more resources available when we are presenting the budget, so we could be able to even look at it in a much better manner. There was a question about inadequate representation to SC and ST and minorities. I must tell you that we have more than in 31st 17.76% and 7.8% respectively SC and ST, which is more than 15% and 7.5% which are required. We already are working on each and every selection committee. There is a representative of the minority to make sure that they are not discriminated against. In RPF, and my women, my sisters and the members of parliament who are for women MPs, they are asking about RPF increase. So that again, we are trying to make sure that more women are recruited for that. One of my friend from West Bengal, a sister, asked me a question about Izzat scheme. And she said, the Izzat scheme, which was started by Mamta ji, was discontinued by us. The scheme is still on. Only change that was made when last year, when we were not in the government, was from 15-8-2009 by Mamta ji started it. It was increased, it was only modified to make 1,500 per month as the certificate of income has to be given, but that was not something which we did it. This was already done earlier. So that scheme continues. So it is not, the scheme is continuing and we are not discontinued with it. So we really are working on that. Yes. So this is the broad picture about what we are trying to do for the state. I am very happy to say that my friend who was asking me this question, very valid one of course, is what are we doing about the social issues? And I think that is something which is an extremely important, and that, madam, I will try to cover it very quickly. Madam, as I mentioned, we already started the self-help group and ethnic food to be served on railways on an experimental basis in Konkan Delhi. But we would like to continue that with many other places. Skill development, which is a very important program and a priority for a Prime Minister. We are working with my colleague, friend and minister, Mr. Rajiv Pratap Rudi, to also involve the railways in this effort. And auto rickshaw and taxi drivers also we are really developing. The employees. And this time we deliberately provided for them because they don't have voice here, is that we have provided for the quarters, holiday home. We are also trying to work on a health card for each of them. So madam, the point I'm trying to tell you is that this budget is something which is an effort, a small little effort, to correct the so many problems that railway had. And is it something, I'm not even saying that I will be able to do it myself, unless I have the support and the complete backing of all the people, not only in this house, but across the country. Then only we'll be able to fix the problem of the railways. And I appeal to all of you that let us look at it as a national endeavor. Let us look at it as a national duty. Let us look at it as something which we have to put in place together, and we will try to solve the problem. So let me appeal to all of you and thank you again for participating in the budget. But as I will move a little later, the resolution to support the budget. So let me once thank you. And each of the points that you have mentioned, I will assure you again, is already here with me. We'll work on it. And I think we'll try to solve as much as possible, and we'll try to come back to you if necessary. Thank you.